Trivia question for you guys. You land at the Cancun airport. You're headed to Tulum. It's an hour and a half, 2 hour drive. What is the lowest realistic price you can get away with paying a taxi to go from Cancun airport to Tulum? I will answer that in just a few minutes, but that is the type of practical info I'm going to give you today on this video. If you clicked on this video, you're probably thinking about going to Tulum, or you are going to Tulum, and you're looking for answers. I'm going to give you those answers. And real quick, big picture wise, if you're going to Mexico, Colombia, Brazil, I promise if you subscribe to my channel, there should be a subscribe button down here in the bottom right corner. If you're watching full screen on your phone or on your laptop, please subscribe. I promise you, you will have a better experience, especially going to Mexico, Colombia, Brazil, if you're subscribed to my channel. Okay, let's answer that taxi question. Oh, and regarding taxi prices, just for perspective, you can take the bus. It's called ADO, A-D-O, that's A-D-O, the ADO bus. That one is about $15, but it does stop in Playa del Carmen along the way, so it's gonna take you a little bit longer to get to Tulum instead of just having a taxi pick you up and go straight to your Airbnb or hotel. So that's the bus. And then also, if you're looking online and you book, say, a taxi online, or you just get to the airport and pick any given taxi out there, it's gonna be at least $100, probably $110, $120, $130 for that ride. So if you text my guys, I'm about to give you their number, they can give you a better price. You can work it out with them. Everything's negotiable in Mexico. Okay, so to answer the taxi question, the answer is about $70. Now you have to work this out with a taxi driver, normally over WhatsApp. So what I'm gonna do here is I'm gonna give you two of my favorite taxi drivers that I used in Tulum. I'm gonna give you their number and you can text them in WhatsApp. If you don't know Spanish, it's okay. Use Google Translate or text them in English. I promise you, you guys will figure it out between Google Translate and these guys working with extranjeros, foreigners, all the time in the taxi. So let me give you these two guys a number. The first one was my go-to guy's name's Josue Perez. So that's not Jose, it's Josue. So there's a U in between the S and the E. So his number is +52. That's the Mexico country code. You need that on WhatsApp. +52. And then the number after that is 198-414-10608. Again, that's Josue Perez. That's Jose with the U between the S and the E. If you don't know how to spell Jose, I feel sorry for you. So is the tractor below. And the number is +52-198-414-10608. The other guy, his name is Salvador Tuk, T-U-K. Depending on how much you know about Mayan history, I don't know much, but that is a Mayan name. This guy is really cool, and he is actually Mayan, and his family is from Tulum for generations. So this is the real deal. So if you want to really, really support local, use Salvador Tuk. That's Salvador, S-A-L-V-A-D-O-R, and last name Tuk, T-U-K. His number, again, +52, Mexico country code, and his number is 984-141-6754. So those are my two main taxi guys. I contacted them before this video, asked them if it'd be okay if I shared you guys' number. They said yes. So text those guys, set up your taxi rides. They can take you anywhere. I don't get anything from them. Just trying to help you guys out because these are real things that people need in Tulum besides just Googling the cool Instagram places and things like that. Also, what else was I going to say about the taxi drivers? Another good thing about the taxi drivers is even if they're busy, they always have friends, especially Salvador being from Tulum his family for generations. So, you know, if you're in another part of Quintana Roo or the Yucatan, they can take you. They have friends everywhere. So they'll be like, hey, I'm busy tomorrow, but my buddy will pick you up or whatever. So they can always work something out. Now, where to stay in Tulum? I'm going to talk about four different neighborhoods. The first one being the actual beach area, and then work our way to the next two, three, four neighborhoods that are, respectively furthest from the beach. So starting with the beach, let me be clear. I don't recommend it. Don't recommend it, don't recommend it, don't recommend it. It is the food. I'm gonna talk about this in a little bit, but the food is not good at all. If you're looking at the water, like the worst food in Tulum is normally when you're looking at the water, so basically on the beach. Also, it's the priciest food as well. So you're paying the most and getting like the worst food. Accommodations, near the beach or on the beach road just aren't that good. I mean, even the really, really expensive places, maybe $1,000 a night, it's like, you know, AC is optional, or maybe there is AC, but it's always kind of, it just isn't worth it. It's not a good experience. Now, let me tell you the exceptions. You're a couple. You really just want your private time. You want to wake up, see the water, have a beach balcony, whatever. Cool, stay at the beach. You're 2 or 3 nights. Go for it. But besides that, well, there's one other category that maybe it's a good idea to stay at the beach. You're just a party animal, and you know a lot of the you know beach clubs and things like that, they start early in the night, you know, 9, 10, 11 p.m. On the beach at the beach clubs. So you know, if you're the type that you want to be close to that, you know, you want to, maybe the party's at your hotel or beach club and you want to just walk 20 steps and be in your room after the party or during the party, or walk a few buildings down to your room from the party, then okay, you know, pay the huge premium to stay at the beach. And you know, that is a realistic scenario. And also what I said about the couples, that's a realistic scenario, right? You go to Tulum for the beach, right? So you want to stay close to the beach. I get it. But if you fall into any other category, like you're staying there for a month or two as a digital nomad, really don't recommend staying at the beach. If you are a digital nomad, maybe you stay at Selena Hostel on the beach. I know people that have had a good experience staying there, digital nomads. But I'm going to talk about the other neighborhoods in a second. But there are better places to stay, all things considered, food-wise especially. I'm going to talk about food in a second. Food on the beach really isn't that great and super overpriced. So that concludes my staying at the beach speech. Okay, so let's move on to the next neighborhood closest to the beach. It's called Aldea Zama. A-L-D-E-A-Z-A-M-A, Aldea Zama. Pros of staying in Aldea Zama. You are the closest to the beach without actually being at the beach. The buildings are newer. The Wi-Fi is probably the best Wi-Fi overall in that neighborhood in Aldea Zama. Overall Tulum, Aldea Zama has the best Wi-Fi. It is quiet. You don't have loud street vendors driving around the streets playing their crazy music or their loud speakers. So yeah, there's a lot to like about Aldea Zama. When my family came, my parents, brothers, sisters, and things like that, we stayed. I wanted us to stay in Aldea Zama because yeah, it's a good neighborhood. So a lot of things to like about Aldea Zama. It is a little bit more expensive than the actual town of Tulum, but it's not quite as expensive as staying at the beach. Cons of staying in Aldea Zama: it can be kind of hard to find a taxi. It's kind of weird. They have like random taxi stations, but it's kind of the suburb feel. So you could be walking for 10 minutes and not see a taxi or not see anybody really. It's kind of a weird feel in that neighborhood. So it's best to solve that problem, have a taxi or 5 taxis in your phone that you can text and set up rides. Because if you have dinner reservations at 8, you need to set that up. Because if you have dinner reservations at 8 and you're trying to find a taxi in Aldea Zama at 7:45, you may not find one for 15 or 20 minutes if you're just walking around. So that is a Tulum best practice. Have taxis in your phone that you can set up a ride, pick us up at 7:45. Here's our address in Aldea Zama. So that's one con, trying to find a taxi. The other con is, it's so quiet in Aldea Zama, so you don't really feel, it's mostly foreigners that stay there, Americans, Europeans, and things like that. So you don't really feel like you're in Mexico, but maybe, you know, you might be okay with that, but there's some restaurants there, but again, it feels very new, very fresh in that neighborhood. You know, the heart of Tulum is the town of Tulum. That's where you really feel the energy of the locals, some of the better food and things like that. So that's some of the cons of, those are really the only two cons of living in Aldea Zama. It's kind of hard to find a taxi sometimes, and it's just so quiet, and you know, you don't really feel like you're in Mexico. So to summarize, pros of staying in Aldea Zama: good Wi-Fi, new buildings, quiet neighborhood, you're the closest neighborhood to the beach. Cons: hard to find a taxi, and it can be kind of too quiet in that neighborhood. Okay, now moving to the next neighborhood that is closest to the beach. But we talked about the beach, we talked about Aldea Zama. The next neighborhood would be El Centro Tulum, or in English we say sometimes the town of Tulum, and it's also common even the Americans, we just say El Centro. Everyone knows El Centro, the center of Tulum. This is where I stay. This is my favorite place to stay, especially if you're staying for 2 weeks, a month, 2 months as a digital nomad. Okay, let's start with the pros of living or staying in El Centro of Tulum. The food. The best food overall in Tulum is in El Centro. And guess what? It is low cost or reasonably priced food. You're not going to be paying an arm and a leg for a taco if you're eating in El Centro. So that's a big draw for me, being close to the best food, and it's also reasonably priced. So it's a win-win on the food front. Number two, walkability. You can walk a ton of places in El Centro. It's easy to meet up with friends. It's easy to go to the grocery store and get your electrolyte for hangovers or buy bananas or water or what have you. That is another pro of staying in El Centro. If you're staying in Aldea Zama, you can't. They have one little mini mart that you can walk to. Other than that, you have to get your groceries delivered or take a taxi to go get groceries. So El Centro has all the conveniences, or it's probably the most convenient neighborhood to live in. Obviously, you can't walk to the beach. Well, you could walk to the beach from El Centro, but it might take you an hour. Another pro of El Centro is everything is reasonably priced. You can get a pretty good apartment or Airbnb or hotel in El Centro and not pay an arm and a leg for it. So I stayed in El Centro the most for months, and it's my favorite neighborhood overall because of the walkability, because of the convenience of being close to food, grocery stores, and also some good restaurants and bars. And again, the bars and restaurants aren't going to charge you an arm and a leg in the town of Tulum. Also, you're going to feel like you're in Mexico. It's the authentic Tulum is the town of Tulum. The cons of staying in El Centro of Tulum is that the Wi-Fi may not be that great. So if you're a digital nomad, you may not have the best Wi-Fi in your Airbnb. I will say there was a place that had great Wi-Fi that my friend stayed at. It was called Casa Turquesa, like turquoise, but in Spanish. Another downside of staying in El Centro is it can be loud. There are vendedores, salesmen in the street all the time with their loudspeakers playing their loud music. There's these like gas trucks that go around just playing loud music, because if you need gas for your home, you just have to wait until you hear the music and you run outside and stop the guys. So those are the two cons of living in El Centro, is it can be a little bit loud, especially if you're trying to make a video. And also the Wi-Fi may not be the best Wi-Fi that you can find in Tulum. But again, El Centro is where I spend most of my time. Even I think 2 months living there, loved it, would stay there again. And it's my favorite neighborhood in all of Tulum for the day-to-day conveniences that you get while living there. Also, you get to feel like you're in the real Tulum. You get to feel like you're in Mexico, and you know that charm that the original Tulum has or had. Okay, and the last neighborhood we're gonna talk about is the neighborhood that's furthest from the beach. It's called La Valeta. Now, if you've looked at Airbnbs in Tulum, you've probably looked at some places in this neighborhood because they have the best prices. They're the cheapest, it's the cheapest neighborhood to live in. That is one of the pros of living in La Valeta. After that, I don't really know many pros of living in La Valeta. It's my least favorite neighborhood in Tulum because it's not walkable, it's not convenient. There is one coffee shop that may or may not be close to where you're staying in La Valeta. And there's some restaurants that aren't necessarily my favorite. They do the job. But overall, living in La Valeta, you stay in La Valeta maybe because you want to save money on where you're staying, but then you're going to be paying more for a longer and more expensive taxi ride to get to the beach. And you're not really close to even a pharmacy to walk to. I can't even think of where a pharmacy is in La Valeta. I'm sure there's one. You guys can let me know. But La Valeta is just, for day-to-day living, even for a 2 or 3 day trip to Tulum, I don't really recommend it. I don't know. I'm just not a fan of La Valeta. If you had a good stay, let me know in the comments below. Maybe I'm missing something. But I think El Centro is the best place to stay. Aldea Zama is the best place to stay, especially if you need good Wi-Fi, want a newer building, want to be the closest you can be to the beach without being at the beach. And then staying at the beach obviously has its perks, especially if you're a beach lover and you want to see that sunrise or see the water on your balcony or walk out of your room and be stepping on sand. But La Valeta, just not a fan of it. It's the furthest away from everything. And you'll save some money on your per night stay, but you're gonna be paying more in taxis. You're gonna be in a taxi longer to get to and from La Valeta. Okay, let's talk about bikes real quick in Tulum. Perception of Tulum is that it's this tiny town. All the blogs and videos talk about biking in Tulum. So you think, hey, this is great. Let's book an Airbnb look, our Airbnb has free bikes. We're gonna bike everywhere. We won't even need a car. We're gonna eat vegan. We're gonna lose some weight, et cetera, et cetera. reality, it doesn't really play out that way. Here's why. If you're staying in El Centro or La Valeta, it is a 30-minute to an hour bike ride, depending on where you're going along the beach. Throw in some really hot weather, and you're sweating your butt off just to get to the beach or leaving the beach. And on top of that, the free bikes at your Airbnb are probably really low quality bikes that break easily or just take a lot of work to pedal. So it just doesn't really play out that way. If you're just a super biker, is that what they call it? I don't know. If you're just really into biking, what you probably want to do is rent a really nice bike, and that'll make your life a lot easier because the free ones just aren't all that great. But yeah, that's just the reality of it. Okay, so now let's talk about where to eat in Tulum. Let's start with my favorite meal of the day, breakfast. In El Centro, let me be clear, if you don't take anything else from this video, please go to this place for breakfast, Botanica Garden Cafe. It's in El Centro. The owners are super nice. They have the coolest story ever about how they opened it up. The food is made with love. It's super local. It feels like it's homemade. It probably is. And I just love this place. It's their restaurant is basically in a big garden. And it's my favorite place. It really encompasses what Tulum is or what Tulum used to be or what it should be. And great food, reasonably priced. The huevos rancheros there are super good. I highly recommend them. So Botanica Garden Cafe, that's the place I recommend that you go for breakfast. Love this place. And I hope you check it out. Staying with breakfast, another one of my favorite places for breakfast is Kibak Cafe. It is right there in El Centro. Heads up, you probably walk by it and you think it's just a simple little counter serve coffee shop. That's what it looks like. But if you walk in, there's two extra big rooms in that restaurant. Actually, it's not just a tiny coffee shop. And then they also have a second and third and fourth floor rooftop deck as well that you may not see if you don't look up. So Kibok is K-I-B-O-K. Kibok Cafe has great breakfast, great coffee as well. And this place is really underrated for food, but they have some of the best and healthiest and well-made food in Tulum. It's actually at Straw Hat Hostel, which can be a pretty party hostel at night, but somehow they managed to be a party hostel at night, but have just great food as well, especially for breakfast. Really healthy food, a lot of superfood options. Their restaurant is called Juice Lover, which isn't a great name for a restaurant because it makes it sound like they only have juices and smoothies. One of my favorite places to eat breakfast as well. So those are three of my favorite breakfast places. They're all in El Centro. Number one was Botanica Garden Cafe. Number two was Kibak, and then number three was Straw Hat Hostel, aka Juice Lover. Okay, let's talk about eating at the beach real quick. Don't recommend it. I'm serious. Whatever you can do, eat breakfast in El Centro, then go to the beach. I'm telling you, your life will be better. You'll save a lot of money. You'll eat better. The food actually on the beach, if you're looking at the water or you can feel sand, you're probably eating some of the worst food in Tulum. It's also the most expensive food in Tulum. Not really recommended. But along the beach road, I'm saying beach weird. Anyway, along the beach road, there are some great higher end restaurants. One of my favorite ones is called Meze. Don't even know how to pronounce the name of that place, but it is really good food, really good environment. And like I said, along the beach road, a lot of the restaurants actually aren't even that great, but this place is really good. It's probably my favorite restaurant. Along the beach road, you can't see the beach or the water from this restaurant. It's what we call along the jungle side of Tulum. Heartwood, you've probably heard about it. It's good. It's expensive, but it's good. It's a good experience, especially if you're in Tulum, to go to Heartwood. You got to make reservations a month or two in advance via email only, but I do recommend Heartwood. You've probably already read or heard about it as well. Another Tulum favorite is Macha Mama. There are two locations. There's one in El Centro Tulum, and also one along the beach road on the jungle side. I recommend it as well. It's a great place. It has really good acai and smoothies and coffee and matcha and all sorts of good stuff. Okay, so those were some of the restaurants along the jungle side of the beach road. Let's talk about some of my favorite restaurants and where you should go in El Centro Tulum. Let me tell you, there's this place called Tres Galeones, like Tres and then Galeones, G-A-L-E-O-N-E-S. this place, it's not even that busy a lot of times, so you think it's not good, but trust me, it is great. They have really good seafood tacos. I'm not even a fan of, you know, seafood tacos. I was like, oh, I want to try some shrimp tacos. But I love it there. They have octopus tacos, shrimp tacos, and burritos. And the place is just really, really good. Really good cocktails as well. It is across from the ADO bus station, ADO bus station. And it's kind of in between El Centro and La Valeta on the main road in El Centro. So I highly recommend Tres Galeones. In La Valeta, there's a restaurant called Humo, H-U-M-O, which means smoke in Spanish. The decoration in there is really cool. The food is really good. The drinks are really good. That is more of that's a really good restaurant that isn't quite as famous in Tulum, but definitely embodies the feel of Tulum. Let's talk about tacos real quick. I'm going to tell you the name of one place that has really good cochinita pibil tacos. The name is Taqueria Honorio. Honorio. Taqueria Honorio. I never said it right. Even though I speak Spanish, I can never say it right. But Taqueria Honorio, it is H-O-N-O-R-I-O. Taqueria, H-O-N-O-R-I-O. It is across from a restaurant called Del Cielo, basically. And they have some of the best tacos in all of Tulum. Also, sorry to burst your bubble, but Tulum does not have that great of tacos compared to other places in Mexico. And Mexican food, for that matter. Tulum doesn't really play all that well in the Mexican food space. So a hidden gem bar in El Centro Tulum is called Elixir, E-L-I-X-Y-R. It's spelled a little funny, E-L-I-X-Y-R. They have a really cool rooftop pool and vibe and pretty good cocktails. They also have a random green bean hummus. Never thought I'd try that, but I liked it there. So I highly recommend going to Elixir as well, especially if you're just with a small group or one other person, you just want to chill and be away from all the craziness at the beach or even in the main part of El Centro Tulum. Highly recommend Elixir. And while we're talking about hidden gems or really local spots in El Centro, there's a place, if you really want to party with the locals, I mean, everyone always says that, right? Oh, I want to eat with the locals. I want to eat with the locals. You don't want to party with the locals. If that's what you truly, really want when you go to Tulum, there's a place in El Centro called Satellite 307, Satellite 307. I mean, this is local, local, local. It's like a little sports bar, wings place. But on Friday and Saturday nights, they have a DJ and play music and things like that. But that's like the real local stuff. I mean, you probably won't see other foreigners there. So if that's what you want, go check out Satellite 307, Satellite 307. All right, let's talk about coffee shops. So the three places are Cara Feliz, Happy Face in Spanish. Cafeína, caffeine in Spanish. And the third one is Prieto. So these were three of my favorite places to go and have maybe acai or coffee while I'm working. They have decent Wi-Fi, not amazing Wi-Fi, but just a good ambiance and things like that at these three coffee shops. Cara Feliz has a bookstore feel. It's actually really hard to get in because they really only have seating for probably like 10 people, but it's a really cool place. They have a patio as well. Cafeína, I really like. They have some of the best matcha that I had in Tulum, and most others would agree with me. And the last one, Prieto, is along the main road of El Centro. You probably will walk by it or see it many times. It really only has seating for probably 5 or 6 people, but it can be a good place to work. And they also have really good acai there as well. So to summarize my three favorite coffee shops in El Centro, it was Cara Feliz, C-A-R-A, and then Feliz. Cafeína, number 2, and then number 3, Prieto, P-R-I-E-T-O. All right, so now let's talk about the beach. And to talk about the beach in Tulum, we need to define a common phrase you hear in Tulum, beach club. Now, to me, a beach club would mean somewhere that's like a club, loud music, popping bottles, things like that. But in Tulum, a beach club is anything that touches the beach. Everything's a beach club that has sand underneath it in Tulum. So we have to categorize the beach clubs. There are chill beach clubs that maybe you go with your boyfriend or girlfriend to chill out, drink a margarita. You don't want loud music. You don't want a lot of Instagrammers and things like that, annoying YouTubers. Then there is turn up beach clubs that we're going to talk about as well. Okay, so let's start with turn up beach clubs because I'm going to spend the least amount of time on these. Vagaloom and Taboo. You probably already heard about them. You've probably already booked your table or beach bed and bottle at these places. So Taboo and Vagaloon. Now you know, let's move on. Actually, I kind of have like a secret number to make reservations at Vagaloon. I actually never went, but that's a different story. But it is a good number. So if you need that number, hit me up in the comments or email me. You can find my email in the about section of my channel and I will give you that reservation number. And while we're talking about somewhat famous places, let's talk about beach club fancy places that are in the chill category. You've probably heard about these places, but this is an informational Tulum video, so let's cover them real quick. So you have Beach Tulum, Casamauca, and Nomad. Those are the three bougiest chill beach clubs. That sums up some of the fancy chill beach clubs. Let's talk about two of the most local places you can find on the beach. I'm talking tacos and beer only, first come, first served on the beach furniture, that type of stuff. So number one, love this place. It's called Eufemia. Eufemia. Seriously, all they have here are tacos and beer, nothing else, really cheap, people smoking weed. And I mean, this was like the original Tulum. They play music from hip hop to old school Mexican music and everything in between. This is where a lot of the Mexicans that are visiting Tulum, they go to this beach club as well. So that, again, that place is called Eufemia, and that is like the real feel of Tulum, what Tulum, you know, the local Tulum, that's where the locals go. The local workers on their day off, they go to Eufemia. So I really recommend going to that place if you want a good local feel. Okay, another really local spot is called Playa Paraíso, Paradise Beach. This is kind of on a different side of the beach. Don't know how to explain it, but you'll understand when you get to Tulum. It's a different area away from all the boutique hotels. And that's where locals go as well. Playa Paraíso. There are some more low-key beach clubs there. But also, that's where the public beach is. So if you want to take a cooler and food and drinks and go just chill with friends, lay on a towel on the beach, then you can do that as well near the Playa Paraíso area. If you're looking for a chill beach club that has beach beds, even swings to take pictures at, good smoothies, good margaritas, some good food, there's a place called Limited Coco, or I think it's Coco Limited, one of the two. That is a good place just to go chill, maybe go with your significant other or a small group, family, and yeah, just go there, enjoy food, drinks, and the beach, a little bit of background music. All right, let's talk about cenotes. I'm actually only gonna talk about one cenote. I'm gonna keep it real simple. Casa Tortuga. Casa Tortuga. Go to this cenote. It's about a 20 minute taxi ride to get to Casa Tortuga. Now at this cenote, Casa Tortuga, there's actually four cenotes. Two of them are what they call open cenotes. So it's like open air cenotes. And you don't need a tour guide for this. So if you're like me, just get there and they may try to get you to go on these tours to go see the other two, what they're called closed cenotes, which are like cave cenotes. For me, I just like to go like to someone that feels like a natural swimming pool, jump off some rocks, things like that. I don't really want to go in the cave and all that stuff and snorkel. That, you know, dark water in caves wasn't really my thing. I want to just go enjoy the open air cenote. So when you get there, just be like, if you're like me, just be like, hey, I don't want to go on the tours. Just I'm going to go to the open cenotes by myself. That way you don't have to pay for a tour and all that stuff. But hey, if you want to go, you know, in the caves and the water and things like that, then by all means, go for it. And you can see the two open air cenotes and the two closed cenotes, as they call them, as well. So just keep that in mind. Yeah, they even have now a little bar and pizza place next to these cenotes. So you can get drinks or even pizza if you want to while you're at these cenotes. Casa Tortuga is where I took any friend or family member that visited me in Tulum. And everyone always loved it, and I went multiple times and enjoyed it every time. So again, Casa Tortuga, that's the only cenote I'll talk about today. If you think that I provided you with something valuable today, please like this video and please subscribe to my channel. I promise you there will be more good content coming your way that will help you have a better experience when you travel to Latin America. And if you have any questions, please put them in the comments below. I will answer you. I promise you, I will do everything I can to make sure you have a good experience when you go to Tulum. Thanks so much, and talk to you guys soon.